Double, double, toil and trouble. Fire burn and cauldron bubble. Fillet of a finny snake in the cauldron boil and bake. Eye of newt and toe of frog, wool of bat and tongue of dog. Adder's fork and blindworm's sting. Lizard's leg and owlet's wing. For a charm of powerful trouble, like a hell broth boiled in bubble. Double, double, toil and trouble. Fire burn in cauldron bubble. This is Carolina Haynes. Welcome, dear listeners, to the Carolina Haynes Podcast, brought to you by Wreak Havoc Productions and A Darker World. I'm your host, Dan Sellers. A lot of people make the mistake of assuming the Uwharries Mountains and the Uwharries National Forest are in the mountain region of North Carolina because, well, it has mountains right there in the name. It's tough for some folks to wrap their heads around the fact that the Piedmont region could have mountains. But it does. The picturesque Sourtown Mountain Range in the northern Piedmont and the Uwharries Mountains to the south. National Forest covers virtually all of Montgomery County, North Carolina, stretching from Albemarle to Candor. Baden Lake and Lake Tillery border it to the west, and I-74 to the east. Many strange occurrences have come from the Uwharries over the years, including numerous Bigfoot reports, which we'll likely cover in a future episode. But the Uwharries are also known for witch stories. Perhaps the best known Uwharries witch was Anne Blackhand, but no one ever called her that. She was known to everyone as the Tuckertown Witch. Anne was a cruel, nasty woman who enjoyed nothing more than spreading misery and misfortune to anyone that drew her attention. Anne was by far the most evil woman anyone in the county had ever met. Most of the time, her vile hatred had no particular agenda. Just whoever was unlucky enough to cross her path. If a farmer caught her eye, his fields may wither, or his cow's milk run dry. If a merchant offended her in some way, they may find themselves with an illness of some sort. If a woman earned her gaze, she might find herself with marital problems. In fact, that was a favorite pastime of the Tuckertown Witch. She would pick a church in the county, and then the divorce rate among its members would inexplicably skyrocket. Couples who had been happily married for decades suddenly were unable to stand the sight of each other, or otherwise faithful men would be tempted into adultery. But then one day, Anne Blackhand's reign of terror came to an end. The town woke to the sound of Anne screaming from her house on the edge of town. It sounded as if she was in excruciating pain, but no one dared to go help for fear that it may be some kind of trap. No one wanted to be on the receiving end of her hideous wrath. But word spread, and soon most of the town had gathered outside of Anne's cottage. Finally, a group of women mustered up the courage to go inside and check on her. They opened the door to find Anne doubled over in pain, clutching her stomach. When Anne saw the women, she pleaded to them for help and mercy. When they opened the door, a large chair slid across the room on its own, blocking their entry. It took all of them together and several minutes to move the chair out of the way. Finally, they went to Anne, but nothing they did was any comfort to her. When all other options had failed, the women couldn't think of anything else to do. They gathered around her bed and prayed.
Saint Michael the Archangel,
Anne's pain immediately intensified, but she begged them not to stop. At last, she arched her back and let loose a scream like none of them had ever heard before. The cry lasted for what seemed like an eternity, and as she wailed on, a black mist escaped Anne's mouth and hung over the bed. When the scream finally subsided, Anne collapsed into sweaty exhaustion, but the mist still hovered in the air. It became more substantial, gathering into a black, viscous mass that resembled a ball of tar. Then it rolled itself across the room toward the door. But unlike tar, whatever the substance was left no residue or trace behind as it moved across the floor. The crowd outside parted as it rolled out of the house and into the woods. When the shock eventually wore off, people sprinted into the woods after it, but they never found a trace of the strange mass. And Anne? Well, Anne recovered. But she was no longer the Tuckertown Witch. From that day forward, whenever she entered a church, it was to pray. Whenever she stopped someone on the street, it was to wish them a good day, or compliment their dress, or apologize for her former behavior. Whatever evil may or may not have been inside Anne Blackhand had seemingly left her body that day, along with the black mass. Today, Tuckertown is no more. The area was flooded in 1962 to make Tuckertown Reservoir Lake. But Tuckertown wasn't the only Uwharries area played with the witch. There is another very odd tale from the Uwharries about an indestructible lizard. One day, a woman named Jenny was working in her garden when a lizard popped its head over a nearby rock and watched her. At first, she didn't even notice. There wasn't much out of the ordinary about the reptile, just an ordinary eastern fence lizard. You've probably seen plenty yourself. A 6 or 7 inch long, common brown lizard, perhaps with faint stripes running the length of the body. The only difference anyone could see in this lizard was that it wasn't shy. The eastern fence lizard is typically very timid and would flee from the slightest glimpse. This one was different. When Jenny finally noticed it, it was fully perched up on top of the rock, watching her. She immediately felt a chill run down her spine, but didn't associate the feeling with the lizard. She looked around and didn't see anyone. She went back to her gardening, but found it hard to concentrate. Was that her imagination? Or could she actually feel the little reptile watching her? She looked up. Sure enough, there it was, still watching. She felt an unexplainable, ominous presence about the small creature. It was drawing her gaze. It was hypnotic. She wrestled her attention from it, picked up a small pebble, and tossed it at the lizard to scare it away. The pebble bounced harmlessly nearby, and that did the trick. The animal skittered away. But Jenny was shaken. What had just happened? She cleaned up what she was working on and went back inside. The encounter was so odd that she didn't even mention it to her husband. But the experience was not over. From that day forward, she saw the lizard often. And each time she felt off, like it was trying to get inside her mind. And she didn't just find it in her garden. It would follow her around. When she went into town, there was the lizard. When she came out of church service, there was the lizard. In fact, everywhere that Jenny went, the lizard was sure to go. She just knew that it was an evil little creature. She knew that it wanted to possess her. She couldn't quite explain to anyone why she felt this way, but everyone could see something strange was going on. At first, most people who heard her talking about it just looked at her sideways and shook their heads, and even openly laughed. Poor Jenny's lost it, they said. But the laughter stopped as the looks turned from pity to curiosity when they began seeing it too. The people that Jenny talked to during the day would see a small brown lizard. They didn't notice anything out of the ordinary about the lizard, and they certainly didn't feel like it was going to hypnotize them into its evil lizard cult, but they couldn't help but notice that it really did seem to follow Jenny around wherever she went. Her family began to get concerned for her. No one quite believed the animal was evil, but they could see the impact it had on her, and they feared for her sanity. Whenever they saw the lizard, they would throw rocks at it to scare it away. Over time, the critter got braver and braver. It became harder and harder to scare it away. Even a direct hit with a rock wouldn't faze it. It would skitter away when it was good and ready, not before. Jenny's father, however, just furrowed his brow at the animal, spat a stream of tobacco juice out of his mouth, and grunted. It even started to find its way into their home and watched Jenny from the doorway. Jenny would now become hysterical whenever she saw it. Her family had enough of it. Her husband and her brother rounded up their rifles and shotguns, and the next time it slithered under the front door, they unleashed a barrage of firepower that D-Day would be proud of. When the smoke cleared, there sat the lizard, mocking them. Then, when it was ready, it lifted its head and seemed to stare back at all of them. It flicked its tongue a couple of times and turned and skittered back out of the door. As usual, her father watched what had happened, spat a stream of tobacco juice into a spittoon, and grunted. But this time his grunt was in the form of a word. Witch. They all turned to look at him. Witch? He got up and walked out back to his work shed. Of course. Why hadn't they seen it before? Everyone believed that there was a witch in the community. Mr. Calway had had a couple of cows mysteriously die. Mr. Springer had a hog give birth to horribly deformed piglets. And everyone thought that old Lady Dutcher was the culprit. But no one could prove it. When they confronted the old lady about it, she just laughed her evil, vile laugh. No one was ever quite sure she was a witch or just a hateful old hag. What no one knew was that Jenny's father had concocted a plan. The tales told that only a silver bullet would kill a witch or supernatural being. So, out in his work shed, he made a couple of silver bullets. He kept all this a secret from his family, but from that day forward, he made sure to have a loaded musket hidden close to him nearby. Then he waited. He didn't have to wait long. A couple days later, Jenny was out in the garden where all this started. The old man waited until she was outside, then moved to the window where he could keep watch. Sure enough, a few minutes later, the lizard slithered out of the bushes and back onto a rock. The same rock from the beginning of the story. Again, it watched Jenny. Her father reached for his musket and carefully latched the window. He steadied himself and took aim. Jenny finally noticed her evil little twin had screamed. Her scream was cut short by the report of her father's musket. She watched as a silver bullet found its mark and the tiny creature somersaulted through the air, landing a few feet away. She looked between the lizard and her father, the lizard and her father. Father simply drew the musket back inside the window, spat a stream of tobacco, and grunted. At that moment, the clock struck two, and he closed and latched the window. Witch, he muttered. With each passing second, Jenny felt better, lighter. She walked over to the lizard just in time to see it take its dying breath. She was finally free. Later, they learned that afternoon, old Lady Dutcher had been in town. Just before 2 o'clock, witnesses said she grabbed her chest, let out a horrifying scream, and dropped dead. To learn more about these stories, check out Daniel Barefoot's North Carolina's Haunted 100, Volume 2, Piedmont Phantoms. There's Fred T. Morgan's Haunted Uwharries, Ghost Stories, Witch Tales, and Other Happenings from North America's Oldest Mountains. This episode was researched and written by Jeffrey Cochran, was produced and hosted by me, Dan Sellers. You can find everything Jeff's up to at his company, A Darker World, at adarkerworld.com. You can find everything that we're up to at wreakhavocproductions.com. Be sure to like the official Facebook page at facebook.com/CarolinaHaints. I'm on Instagram at Wreak Havoc Productions and on Twitter at Hank vs. the Undead. You can find the Carolina Haints podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, Spotify, iHeartRadio, and YouTube. Be sure to like and subscribe and leave us a review. And most importantly, be sure to share it with a friend that likes spooky stories. You can find everything about Carolina Haints, including the Carolina Haints book, at our website, carolinahaints.com. And as always, you can reach out to me directly at carolinahaints@gmail.com. We'll be back in 2 weeks with a new episode. Tune in then to hear more about those things that go bump in the night.